of Richard's work by Peter Hahn from our neighbor institute, the DIW. After the lecture, there will be time for a number of questions. So probably because of this room, the acoustics is not very good. It's good to wait with the questions until the end, unless there's something really pressing. I hope that's okay. But then we'll have some questions in the end, and then there will be some drinks outside. Now, first, let me briefly introduce Peter to you, to introduce the one who's going to introduce Sir Richard. Peter is an applied microeconomist. He heads the department Public Economics at the DIW and is a professor of public finance at Freie Universität. He holds a PhD in economics, and his supervisors were Viktor Steiner, who's here today, and Richard Blundell. So Peter has worked on a number of important topics in public finance, such as how to make pension systems function given that we get older and older, or on the question of what effects childcare have on fertility and labor market participation. Peter, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's a great honor and big pleasure to introduce Richard. Richard Blundell from UCL in London and from the Institute of Fiscal Studies. So I think we all know Richard's papers, academic work. We have seen his journals, we have read the journals, I hope so, and we have cited him. Yeah? Given that we will hear a piece of his research in a minute, I won't talk too much about his research. I just want to emphasize his strength. I think one key strength is really the combination of economic theory with empirical methods. And this combination and the sound identification of the empirical works then help us to derive policy conclusions. And I think this is always coming back in Richard's papers, and I'm sure we will see this here in a minute. Now, let me talk about two different things, not about the research. I want to talk about Richard's policy impact and Richard as a teacher. So the policy impact of Richard is, of course, very closely related to the work of the Institute of Fiscal Study, which he has been the research director for a couple of years, for many years, and I think he is the influential person there. Now, when we think about Richard's policy impact, I think there are two points which we can make. First of all, the empirical papers or the academic papers he's writing always have a very strong policy content. So he develops methods or models and then to evaluate the effect of a pension reform or very often the effect of in-work credit, so how to make the poor working again, right? How to do this. And the evaluation studies have been influential, I think, for the UK, but as well for countries like Germany. When we go to the ministries, we always refer to this, the experience in the UK and what we have learned from that and how to do this now for Germany. Yeah? The second point is how Richard can communicate complicated results to the general public and to policymakers. And here, of course, the great two examples are the Merlis review and the new microeconomic insights developments or movement, where actually we can see how, yeah, to distill the complex ideas we have and to make them accessible. And when you look at the Merlis review, I mean, it's cited so often and so many policymakers really refer to that. It's not only the content, but the ideas, the researchers, which Richard groups around him and the other people. So I think that's a very important piece of work which is helpful for us. I think the IFS, or the Institute of Fiscal Studies, is kind of a role model for a lot of institutes like the DIW, like the WZB, and other German institutions. I would say the competition we have in German amongst German economic institutions or the public economics department is always who is closest to the IFS and who is most similar to the IFS. I hope we are good at that. So let me then talk about the second aspect, the education. So what do I mean by education? So we are very much looking forward to Richard giving the lecture, but we miss a very important thing here. Richard can't ask questions while he's presenting himself. So when I'm talking about education, I think it's really Richard's strength to ask the right questions and to give comments. So when you present in front of Richard, it's always the first part of the question is very nice because it's friendly, and the second part then is starting with the but, and that is very important then. And even more important is when you discuss with him after. Yeah? And I think the great thing is that it's not only true for other great economists who visit IFS or UCL, that's very much true for first-year PhD students or even master students. So I benefited a lot when I came as a first-year student. I think my students or our students do that as well when they visit ISER, to have the time to really talk with Richard about their work. And I think that's the best education actually we can get as PhD students. That's not only true for the students you supervise, but as well for visitors. And I think that's a great achievement. So in summary, I think it's not only your citations which influence our work, it's really more than that. It's the education which a lot of people sitting here actually have benefited from, and I hope that they will bring this to the next generation so that we have a kind of intergenerational transmission channel of that. Okay, let's turn back to the research. We are very happy to have you to give the talk on household behavior and the inequality, the dynamics of inequality. Richard, your voice, yes.
Thank you very much. I'm never going to live up to that. A great student, I should add. Okay, so I'm an empirical economist, empirical microeconomist. I'm not sure everyone here is even an economist. What I'm describing here is not one paper. I've exploited the fact it's called a lecture to bring different bits of work together. In fact, I was writing a review of this work, so this is a perfect time, perfect opportunity. So thanks, Stefan, Dorothy, Peter, everyone for inviting me. It's great to be here, and I'm around for a couple of days, actually, so I look forward to that. So this piece of work is really empirically data-driven. It's going to have a touch of microeconometrics in it, and a little bit of economics, so bear with me as we go through that. I hope you find it useful. So what I'm going to be talking about here is the different dimensions of economic inequality. There are many inequalities, and WZFB investigates many more that I'm going to look at here, not talking about political or other forms of inequality. Of course, they're related, and perhaps a big mistake here is not to relate them more than I do. But even in economics, there are different forms of, different kind of dimensions of inequality. There's kind of wages, earnings, family earnings, net income, consumption, wealth, and these are typically analyzed by different fields of economics. Those of you not economists might think that economists are apart from everyone. Even in economics, we're not always fully integrated. For example, the first ones, wages and earnings, that's the kind of area that labor economists look at, which I certainly have been accused of being sometimes, although I don't like labels like that, where you look at hourly wages, say, or earnings of men and women, and obviously much in the work on experience and gender gap and all those aspects, and pure inequality in the labour market, that's going to be key there. To some extent, I feel that's the driving force of much of inequality. After all, most of the distribution of income, even at the top, is driven by remuneration at work of some form or another now. And so it's become perhaps even more important to understand what's going on in the labour market. And also the big shocks in the labour market, whether they be the recession, layoffs, promotions, can be good shocks, bad shocks. They're all particularly important in driving inequality. But of course it doesn't stop there. We worry about, of course, inequalities in family earnings, family labour supply, time allocations, what's going on. In fact, labour economists, when they study inequality, typically often study one particular gender. They look at wage inequality among full-time working men or something like that. Of course, those men may or may not be linked to other family members, and we want to know how that works. And the men are doing badly relative to the women, for example, how does that feed through to decisions or outcomes for time allocation, children, all those things? After all, that's very important for inequality. That's typically hidden in a kind of family household economics. Public economics typically takes that as given and then looks at the relationship between the income often earned in the labour market or derived from capital, and then studies the tax and welfare system. It's a good place to be studying social insurance, of course. And then consumption inequality and wealth, I say, is often left to macroeconomists. It's very bizarre that, in fact, one criticism I have had, and many of my colleagues over a long period of time, is that because empirical microeconomists, surprisingly, have less interest in consumption than income, we don't collect very good consumption data at the micro level. And sometimes it's argued, well, it's because it's very hard. It isn't any harder than income data. If you try and collect income data, we know that's very difficult. People have different jobs, different types of remuneration, but they consume different things. And actually, for the poor, consumption is relatively easy to collect because they don't do much except for eat and rent and heat. And so it can be very informative. And of course, sociologists have always collected more consumption data than economists have. And I think what I'm going to argue here, but I've been arguing this for a while, and many of my colleagues has, is that if you want to really understand inequality and how it evolves over, I'm going to study how it evolves over the working life, much less across generations, which you might have been expecting, but I'm thinking of the working life here. And you've really got to bring all these together, and that's the argument here. If you want to, by the way, think about how to design taxes and welfare systems, then you've really got to understand the labour market and also, of course, the capital market and consumption and savings and transfer. So that's going to be the argument here. Okay. So I'm going to use two kind of phenomena that are not happening everywhere in equal amounts, but they're kind of phenomena that have driven lots of interest around the globe and have had political outcomes as well. One is the decline or relative decline of earnings at the bottom of the distribution, especially among men, actually, and I'll show you that in a minute, especially among low-skill men. But among the low skill, relatively. I'll use the US and the UK as empirical examples, drawing from some other data from Scandinavia, partly because they have wonderful data in Scandinavia, but they have some similar features, and comment a little bit on Germany, but I don't know as much as any of you on Germany, so But similar phenomena have happened. And of course, generally growing earnings inequality. So things have been happening at the bottom of the distribution, and they've also been happening at the very top of the distribution. And that's driven a lot of political and economic discourse. And so I want to think of that as a kind of underlying issues. And of course, they, in terms of designing policy, they put a lot of pressure, and we've certainly seen that in the UK, on design of welfare systems, because, of course, there's pressure to redistribute more, naturally, there should be. But the change in nature of the labour market means that there's lots of income. In fact, in the US and the UK, a lot of welfare expenditure goes to families that just have low earnings to top up their earnings. Just being in work isn't sufficient to get you up to a reasonable level in modern society, at least if you're low skill. That's completely changed the way we think about welfare design and has motivated the growth of tax credits, for example. And of course, it's not unrelated to minimum wages and other policies that are about dealing with low wages. So the aim of this research agenda is to, though, look inside families, households, what's going on, and think about how families and households accommodate shocks that are driven mainly from the labour market. So I'm thinking income shocks come along, labour market shocks. How does the family adjust? Why is that particularly important to me, because if you want to think about how to design social insurance, you have to think about how the family's dealing with it, how the individual's dealing with it, and then how the state or society kind of interacts with that. And that's the design problem here. So some background. You probably, it's always good to give a kind of just some figures to back up what's going on here. I'm going to look, a lot of the data will come from the US, because a lot of the interest in policy design is coming in my work from the US and the UK. But just to remind you, at the bottom of the distribution in the US, this is 5 grades of education, male real wages since the mid-70s, so it's a very long haul. The bottom line there, the where there's basically a continual fall since the 1975, is the real wage of a high school dropout. Of course, the composition of these have changed over time, and there's lots of other things. This is descriptive, it's not nothing causal about this. But when you look at this, you can see overall, you really have to go into the college and above to get any real increase in median real wages. That's the median within the group. And that's, of course, driven a lot of interest in this. And to some extent, we've seen, in terms of real terms and relative terms, same thing happened in Germany, and even more so in the UK, a similar phenomena. And I'll show you some of that. A little bit of background, which clearly had some influence on kind of political outcomes more recently. These are the same things. These are median male wages by education and race in the US. And this is just two groups, less than high school, so pretty low educated, and above. So just splitting those groups into two, but with three groups by race, black, white, and other. Other is a bit of a mixed bag, and I'm not going to focus on that, but I'm going to focus on white men. And the white men are the orange diamonds. And if you look at the, again, back in 1975, white men who left high school, before high school, so low-educated white men, were doing as well as educated black men, and not far off educated women, in fact. This is all men anyway, so I've got the figure for women. But of course, what happens over the course, and it's a secular decline, white men drift down to where black men are of similar education levels. And the decline of the white man, low skill white man, is quite an interesting phenomena, and of course drives a huge amount of political discourse as well as economic and other discourse. If I was to plot their mortality rates, you'd see exactly the same. The only group whose mortality has been falling, probably in any modern society, has been low-educated white men in the US. So this phenomenon is quite important. Of course, there's other things going on. This is just measuring wages, if you include incarceration and not working and things like that, you draw a, it's actually a very similar picture, it's in differences. But it's a useful bit of background. And you can see recently I've been trying to put figures together across lots of different economies of these phenomena. This is work with colleagues in the UK and in the US, but we've been trying to do the same for France and now a little bit on Germany as well. And another phenomena that's you can look at here, I haven't got lots of figures, this is just to get some background here. This is the growth in earnings over this period again, a long period. Of course, they're complete, you know, people change and there's different cohorts, but it's giving you a feel. Again, this is by the 5 education groups in the US. And again, you can see the men doing very, very badly. The bottom three groups of low-educated men, which are less than high school, and some college, that means not completing college or not completing a 3-year college, have all seen a real fall. of that type of person in the economy. Of course, not the same people, but looking across time. Whereas women have done much better, and that's partly due to the very low position they started with. So there's a convergence, we know that. And it's also due to, these are earnings, so it's the growth of hours in the labour market as well. Whereas it for men, there's been a relative fall of employment over this period. So interesting differences. Why is that interesting? Well, when we go to the second topic of inequality in that list, you bring the family together. Assortative mating in marriage has increased over time. And you can see if I put the high educated men with the high educated women, that's going to give them a double boost. And people now talk about the marriage premium of education. You know, you link up with somebody who's also doing extremely well. And that's another phenomena. And in this general work, you see that at the top of the distribution, in terms of family earnings, in fact, once you pair men and women together assortatively, like you see in cities and in the labour market, you see a much stronger growth than just looking at men alone, surprisingly. So that's why looking at the family is important. So although the low-educated women have done relatively well, what they've done is reduce inequality within the family, but because of assortative matching and because of the low earning growth at the bottom for men, inequality between families has just increased, and the increasing labour market employment, if you want, of women hasn't done anything to help inequality. Within it has, but not across. And that's a kind of theme. That's true in the UK as well, but it's very true in the US. And I don't know what this looks like in Germany, but I think you'd see a similar thing for the reason I'm going to show you now, which is, so here's Germany, as far as I could get from Moller's work. Again, this is just looking at the 85 to 15. I asked Christian Dussmann why they always look at the 85 to 15, and he said that's the thing we're always given, because Christian Dussmann, my colleague, also plots the 85 to 15. Most of us do 90-10, but anyway. You know, it is quite important because things are extreme. Even 90 doesn't really capture what's going on anywhere near the top. 85 is getting a little bit low, but this is when women and men, as far as my German will tell me. This was very very instructive for my German. I translated the notes, by the way. This whole article, and it was the only. I asked Christian, "What's the latest? Tell me the latest on inequality trends in Germany," and he suggested this article. He didn't tell me it was all in German, but I'm pretty sure I know why he didn't. But it's a challenge. So and it's quite interesting, really. You get a strong growth in inequality, you know that, from basically the mid-90s through to, it kind of turns down in this measure. It begins to turn down around the recession, and it, as we know, we'll see, it falls back a bit recently, of course. And this is full-time employees, so it doesn't get any growth of mini-jobs and part-time work and all the things that we'd like to include, but I haven't. I'm just using data here. And of course, if you split by location and gender, this is the 50-15, so this is the bottom, the median to the 15th percentile in the wage distribution from the IEB data. This is no apprenticeship, so it's taking out, removing those low wages. You can see that, again, there's pretty strong growth in inequality, but it's not really happened recently. There's been a fallback, especially among women in the East, but otherwise fairly strong. At the top, you get this growth from women and men, again, falling back a little bit recently, to the point where inequality has fallen a little bit recently, I think, in Germany, in earnings, but not so strongly. What you can see is if I was to sortatively match the women and men here, you get a similar phenomenon because inequality has risen for all of them in a similar way. This was the figure I remember most, and this is the Card and Klein and Heining paper, which could be huge. This got, there was already an interest in German wages, but this was a big interest because this is one of the early papers in the international academic press journals. Of course, it was written way before, it takes forever to get published in economics. So the data finished in 2009. That's probably when they wrote the last version. But don't tell students how long it takes to get published. But you can see that at the 10th percentile, this is full-time men, I think. Yep, on their main job, so not mini jobs or not extra mini jobs, if that's what's happening, you see a big fall. So all I wanted to point out is that this phenomenon, it's different, you know, happening in different degrees and different amounts, but it has happened. It's possibly differences in composition. There's lots of reasons why it may have happened, but you see a similar phenomenon. And so the idea really is to begin to put all these bits together. So when you come to the linkages, now the economics comes in a little bit. We think of insurance, but not just social insurance or regular unemployment insurance. It's every action you can take to ameliorate some unexpected shock or some surprise, some outcome you weren't expecting with probability one, at least, in the labor market, so we're going to call insurance. So it might be self-insurance, like using savings or credit, if you've got it. It might be that other family members try and join the labor market, and there's some evidence of that. It might be that you go and live with other family members, and we know that children moving back home is a well-known insurance mechanism if things go bad, and or perhaps leaving home later because of the labor market being less attractive. So all those things are important. I end with that. But now I try and join all those different measures together by these mechanisms. So when you go from wages to earnings, wages we think of as your hourly pay, largely, if you can measure it. It's hard to measure for everyone, obviously, but for some workers, that's not so bad, or part-time, full-time differences. To go, so that means going from wages to earnings, you're including employment and how much you're working, the intensity of work. We tend to call that labor supply. And then other reactions in the family are going to be family labor supply. Time allocations are going to be important because we worry most, I suppose, about low incomes for families with young children. And time allocation is key there. In fact, one thing I'm going to end with is just pointing out that for the low educated group, at least in the US and the UK, we find that when the family gets hit by a shock, which we're going to treat as the decline in the low-skill white man, women go out to work where they can, and the children lose time with the mother. They don't get anything from the man. The man doesn't seem to do hardly anything to substitute that. And they don't use much formal childcare either, and so it opens up, you know, what happens to children, but the time with the children becomes important. And again, of course, sociologists and others have studied that a long time, but increasingly we're trying to bring in time use data so we find out not just what people are doing at work, but what they're doing at home, and what that might do in terms of the evolution of those other family members, especially young children. So that's going to be important. By the way, it's the opposite at the top. We know that educated women, as they work more, they also spend more time with children. That's an extraordinary phenomena, but it's happened. So this is not a kind of causal shock thing, but if I was just to show you the pattern of women's work at the top of the female wage distribution and the time spent with children, that would actually be rising, surprisingly. They also use expensive childcare, but they spend a lot of time investing with children. And of course, a lot of people have worried about that differential effect now on the children of the rich mothers and the poor mothers. And that's something I might come to because I think it is quite important. There's taxes and welfare. And if you're at the bottom, of course, you've either got other family members or networks or taxes and welfare, because you won't have much in the way of assets. And you'll see that that's about as clear as we would expect in all data. So that's going to be why you really need to look at the way the labour market's being used by other family members to figure out what's going on, and networks and extended family. Thing you'll find that many of you will say is missing here, which is I'll come back to right at the end, is family formation. So one thing you could do if you get, and this is certainly a phenomena, if white men are becoming less attractive in the labour market, they're also less attractive in the marriage market, and we know that's happened in the US because low skill men are just much less likely to be married now than they were. And for whatever reason that is, but that's quite important. So family formation and the timing of children as well. But that's too much, so I'm going to focus on these things, working life. So there's a lot of work behind this. So I said I'm writing a review. This is very unfair on just everybody else who works in this area except my co-authors, so I've just listed my papers. But the main reason to put in this is that all of this work is a huge team effort, and Peter mentioned the Institute of Fiscal Studies. It's like a big laboratory, and you need a laboratory to run experiments. I know that from Georg and others. You need a laboratory to do this kind of work because it's phenomenally intensive in data, and so I'm giving an overview, but I'm certainly not the main player in this work. There's been a kind of revolution in data, I don't have to remind you of that, but there's kind of two aspects to this revolution, both of which I'll use, and this is the non-laboratory experiment revolution. I could have added that as well, perhaps I should have given but the big development really is in administrative data and linkages, and by far the most impressive is of course what's happened in Scandinavia, and I'll give you some work that I do on Norway. Norway is phenomenal because you know everything about everybody, and it's not just what they're doing in the firm. You can link them to a family member, and you can link them to a bank account, and a house, and a car. And that's pretty impressive. So Norway is our little laboratory in this. As I said, it's about the size of Northwest London, so it's a reasonable small laboratory. But what happens is now, working with my colleague, he was my colleague until Chicago stole him, Magni Mogstad, who's a wonderful economist and also has a team of people in addition to the ones we have at UCL and in Chicago. He has a team at Statistics Norway because it's a great amount of work to put these together, but it's been very successful. And what you can do, of course, is particularly link for this kind of work, the work people are doing, their incomes, where they are, the types of, let's call them shocks they're being hit with. Perhaps it's their company's been closed down, or they lose a job, or they're changing their behavior. You can link the people, and you can link assets. And what it means is that by measuring assets, you can construct consumption, not by asking people what they consume. You can do that a little bit, but just by using the budget constraint. And that's new work, but it's kind of obvious. If you do it very carefully, you can get quite good measures of consumption. And one problem with consumption measures in survey is that typically they were measured using diary records, simple two-week diary records. That's the UK approach. And that's become very unreliable. One, because people don't fill in diaries very regularly, but more importantly, the frequency of spending and things has changed. And so you get poor measures. If you're looking at inequality, you can get an increase in volatility just because people are, going to the supermarket every 3 weeks instead of 2 weeks, and So things like that are important. So this bringing together of incomes, the labour market, assets and consumption is really remarkable, and it's driving a lot of new work. We had a paper recently on that. And then the other, which has happened with GSERP, but I'm particularly impressed by the PSID on this, which is a regular survey like GSERP and like the UK panel and most household panels, except they've put especially large amount of effort into collecting consumption, which has happened on a number of panels now. And it's turned out to be very successful. And the way it works is that you do consumption, you count different goods, different broad goods, by a frequency that makes sense. So you ask about consumption of clothing over a longer period than food and things like that. So these are all obvious. But it turns out it works quite well. And now you're getting about 70%, in fact now, about 85% of the budget measured quite well in survey data. Why is that useful? Why is survey data still useful? Well, administration data is good, but for example, it never collects things on time use. It often doesn't collect hours of work, and it often doesn't link family. The Norwegian data does link families together, but it doesn't collect very good data on hours of work, for example, and nothing on time use, because there's no reason why the administrative authority should collect that. So they're always very good at collecting things that are required for tax records or looking at various other aspects of policy, but not everything we want. And so I think there is still room for both of these. Of course, this is very small. It's in the US, it's still about 8,000 families at most, which is very small. The one in the UK has expanded to 50,000 now, but it's still small relative to administrative data. But I'm going to use both of these for fun. Now, a little bit of metrics, but very simple. So it's quite statistical and empirical the way I start this work. So you're just thinking about trying to figure out, when you look at a family, of course there's going to be lots of nuances here, just describing incomes in panel data, in longitudinal data, in the population register. You just follow people, follow families, and you see how their incomes evolve. To begin with, imagine you just looked at income, not looking at all the bits and pieces, just income. And you're going to look at the dynamics of that. Of course, there's some very predictable parts, and then there's unpredictable parts. And you can usefully describe this, economists always have done, as through two components, a permanentish persistent component and one that's fairly transitory. That's already quite a stretch, because if you think about it, there's one series of data and you're getting two things out of it, that requires some assumptions, and you make assumptions to get it. But you can imagine permanent things are things that last over time, transitory things are things that are uncorrelated, and so with enough independence for the transitory parts, you can recover the distribution. And one thing that econometrics has done recently is show how you can identify those, not just the two components, say the variance of them. The variance is quite a good measure of inequality, but it's not perfect, is it? What's nice is to get the complete distribution. So the objective of this work really is to look at how the complete distributions of all the things I started with, wages, earnings, incomes, consumption, and wealth, how they evolve over time and how they link together. And so that's a tall order, but you'd like to know the distributions. And I'll show you why that might be useful as I'm going along here. There's good economic reasoning for this split as well, in the most trivial sense that if you get a persistent shock to your income, say you have a health problem, or you're laid off, or you're promoted, relatively persistent things, then you can, if it's an adverse one, you can kind of, if it's persistence, it's very hard to insure, what we would call insure. That is, if you get hit by a persistent shock, you're probably going to have to reduce your standard of living, reduce your consumption or increase work if you can work, those kinds of things. So we're going to see that persistent shocks to income are more difficult to insure. They're difficult to write a contract over, and they're very hard to self-insure. Whereas, and this is particularly the case of young with low assets. So if you're, you know, the young family and there are two of you who could potentially work if one of you gets hit by a relatively bad shock, health or a layoff or something like that, then all you've got really to rely on is any savings you have. But if you've got low assets, you've got nothing. What other family members are going to do and what the state will do. And so that's what we're going to see. And of course, if you've got children, how you're going to spend your time with children. That's going to be a feature here. So how families cope with persistent shocks will be a particularly important thing. Of course, short-run fluctuations are important too, especially for that group. If you don't have any assets, you can't smooth anyway. So they're important there. And how we put these together, the last little bit of econometrics, just to say it's very simple that we just write income for individual I in period T. So we're following a family or an individual, I'll be more specific. And we have some characteristics, the Zs that we think are predictable perhaps, or we might imagine they're predictable or already known, but they're going to be some things that evolve in a known way. And there's going to be a persistent shock, I'm going to call it eta IT, and a transitory thing. And the persistent shock, if you remember anything about time series, that's an AR1 with a coefficient rho. And in a minute, I'm going to be very critical of this model as a description of the way shocks evolve. So that's why I'm writing it down. That's the standard model. You're going to find that in all, nearly all models of dynamics of income of some kind. And it's not a very good one, it turns out. And we'll see why. A key consideration has been the first thing is to allow the distributions of these things to change over time. The variances, for example, there's a lot more variance in persistent shocks at the beginning of your life and later in the life. And it's remarkable how many models just keep them constant, and that's a very poor thing to do. And different cohorts, we know that, for example, it's very clear in the data that younger cohorts have a bigger persistent variance. That is that younger cohorts joining the labor market seem to have more divergence that's persistence. And you can see that growing over time, quite remarkable. So allowing those things to change has been very important. And if you took the Norwegian data, all the many millions of Norwegians, which is very nice, you could split them a bit. But the kind of thing you might do is just take out some predictable components, just take equivalized household income, so trivial. This is the market income, so this is the income that the families get from the labor market, adjusted a little bit for zeros, but this is taking out the persistent component. And the idea here is, and it holds up very strongly, is that overall you get a higher variance when you're young. You're kind of finding out about the labor market. Sometimes you do better than you thought, sometimes you do worse. You get lucky or you don't. This is taking out lots of things about parents and other things that would be predictable still. And later on in life, where largely, you know, fortunes arise or your health problems arise, all kinds of things. And this is the labor market. So even in the labor market in Norway, you know, there is quite a lot of inequality, actually, quite a lot of variation. But if you bring in social insurance, the whole thing drops down. So, you know, once you bring in social insurance, there's still a bit of a U-shape, but generally there's a huge amount of insurance. So that those fluctuations in the labor market are really dampened. That seems to be true in Germany too, by the way. So when people look at, I think it's true, I think this is in the dissertation tomorrow, that once you bring in all the other features, it looks like there's less impact going through to household incomes. That's a useful thing to note. And it's very much true in Norway. There's a little bit of extra when you bring in family disposable income. That's kind of other bits of income, capital income and things. They're not going to do very much early in life. You don't have much anyway, and there's not too much being transferred in Norway. But that's kind of good. This is, if you look at the low skill, and this is a phenomenon, the low skill. In fact, low skill, you know, not much happens early. If you leave education then you don't do very well in the labour market. You don't get many persistent bumps up or down. You're just bumping along at the bottom. It's quite flat. But once you hit around 50 and you're a low skill, this is low skill by the head of household, which is almost always the man here. The variance gets very high, and that's kind of health shocks. But if I look at family disposable income at the bottom, there is nothing going on. So the social insurance is remarkable. Those big hits that affect people through disability and what have you, completely insured in Norway. And in fact, I've got a picture of consumption variance in Norway, and it's completely flat. I mean, it's unbelievable. Once you look at consumption, there's no inequality left. That's not taking account of housing, but other consumption. Now, how do you link with consumption? Well, if you don't mind me writing some more algebra, the simple way to do that is to look at the growth in consumption and link it to some predictable things, the Zs that are changing, and the two kinds of shocks to income. There are other shocks that are at the end, and they're going to include particularly house price shocks and other things that affect consumption, but I'm focusing at the moment on your labour income. And there's going to be the V thing, that's the shock to persistent income, if you remember. That's going to be the very persistent thing. And if you were really almost a permanent income kind of idea person, where if you get shocked, a permanent change to your income, you have to change your consumption more or less proportionally, then phi would be one. That would be, you have to eat the permanent shocks. And you're going to see, for low-income people, that's what happens. Low-wealth people, that's what happens, largely. Almost. It's nearly one. For those with assets, they deal with it a little bit more easily, of course. And then the transitory shocks, they're also going to be important for liquidity-constrained consumers, for example. And so you begin to unpack dynamics. Of course, if you were one, as I'm going to argue, not perfect measure of inequality, but one measure of inequality is the variance of the log. It's not so bad, actually. Focuses more on the bottom of the distribution than the Gini, for example, and it decomposes nicely. But if you've got everything in log dynamics, this immediately gives you the relationship between the evolution of income inequality, the dynamics of it, and the dynamics of consumption inequality, for example, which is quite nice. And what, in general, you'll get if you were a very neoclassical economist and you were interpreting this, you'd say, well, okay, if I look at phi, that's the insurance of a persistent shock, you'd say, well, okay, what I've got, and I'm sitting here, I've got my assets and I've got my human capital. I get a persistent shock to my income, let's call that human capital for now, and that's going to go on forever. It's persistent or for a long while, and I'm going to try and insure that with my assets. If my assets are small relative to my human wealth, so assets over, then that's not going to do much. Pi will be close to zero, and the shock will go straight through. But if I have a lot of assets, I might be able to insure. Of course, if you've got a short-run change and you have some assets, you can almost completely cover those. So it's very simple. Model. I'm not going to be too dictatorial about the economic model here, though. It's an empirical approach. So I'll just be finding out about these transition parameters and then seeing how they line up with different kind of economic ideas. So it's not completely structural. I call this kind of semi-structural. You're using bits of economics to inform, but not completely determine the model you're working with. So this was consumption, just adding to that figure. It's probably not very interpretable. I should do this better, but basically all that inequality that you saw in market income, it's nearly all gone by disposable income, consumption completely flat. It's kind of quite interesting. That's just kind of running through this model very easily. So these phis and pis tell you how much the shocks are going through to consumption. Of course, they might not be shocks to the person. They're shocks to the researcher, but perhaps the person knew these shocks were coming along. So a lot of the econometrics here is trying to figure out to what extent these are anticipated. And of course, if you've got a panel following people, if something's anticipated, then they will react to it early, and you can consider using what we call advanced information tests for this and try and strip that out. I'm not going to spend any time on that. Imagine we've done our best job to try and strip out the effects. If you were to take the assets in, say, the average person in the US doesn't have much in the way of assets, but has some, because we're going to assume you can borrow against your house, which is not so bad an assumption. What net equity in your house? That's after you take off all mortgage debt. So what you've got left, you could in potential withdraw that with an extra mortgage, and people clearly did that, which was one of the problems of the big run-up to the Great Recession. That would give you a little bit on average. When you look at the data, you get different. Overall, you find that there's kind of more insurance than you might otherwise think, except for the very low-educated. Really, there's not much they can do. They're going to have to eat most of the persistent shock. And there's some other comments I'm going to make there. I'm not going to kind of. So I wanted to just dig a little deeper and kind of introduce you to two aspects of digging a bit deeper. How long have I got? Another 10, quarter of an hour? Yeah, so maybe I might have to speed up. Not quite 49, so it's better than half. But so there are two directions that I wanted to kind of show you as thoughts, and we can go faster. They're kind of new directions. One of them is something kind of quite interesting and pretty obvious, really, that the very simple model doesn't, which almost is like a Gaussian model of shocks, not quite, you could have different tails, but more or less like that. Or a model that just better focuses on the variance, doesn't worry about skewness, kurtosis, let's say, or the unusual things that might happen. And it turns out unusual shocks happen more regularly, perhaps, than the standard kind of simple distribution suggests. And we've kind of been seeing that increasingly, and we've learned about that from the administrative data, because it's hard to detect. But once you know what you're looking for, you can detect it in surveys. I'll show you that. And the other thing is to look at other mechanisms that the family might have. I focused on really assets, but I wanted to go back to the labor supply of other members, what other people are doing in the family. So a kind of example is that imagine your model of income was a kind of job ladder model, very popular in economics now, where you're going up the job, you're in a job and you're going up the ladder, and the process of income is really following something a bit like a random walk, with some shocks. You might be sick one year get a little bit of luck the next year. You might also have some persistent changes, of course. You might get promoted, but you're in a kind of job going up the ladder. But if something happens that knocks you off the ladder, the higher you are up, the further you fall. And in fact, the fact that you had that relatively high permanent income is less important if you have a big negative shock. If you have a small little shock, it's like staying in the job. So these more interesting models of the dynamics of labor income, for example, suggest that the size and sign of the shock you get will affect how important last period's income, the permanent income was. If you think back to the simple time series model that I wrote down, where permanent income was permanent today and, say, rho of yesterday's, The row is exactly the same. So whatever you were at yesterday, it passes on, say, with a 0.9 amount, and then you get a shock. So the persistence of the shock and the persistence of history is exactly the same. It's just rho. And we're going to show that's completely wrong way of describing the data, quite important. And what have we got to show this? Well, here's a picture that got me. I was astonished when I saw this picture. This is the PSID. And it had come because we were looking at the administrative data for Norway, where we found it. And it's been found in lots of administrative data. But what is this? Well, it's a nice picture. And actually, if you want to persuade based on you're doing science, they love this picture. I found that. So persistence is how persistent last period's income is. Going to be the same for permanent income, actually, or similar. And so that's up the axis. You can see go from 0 to 1, thereabouts. And the percentile here is where you were in the distribution last period, the tau of initial. Everything's 0 to 1. It's in a rank from 0 to 1. So if you're at 0.5, you're in the median. You're the median. And of course, it's a uniform distribution, so they're going to be equal people in across this here. These are all conditional quantiles. And that's the shock. So I'll give you an example. So if I take a shock of 0, that's a really bad shock. That's the worst shock that I can see in the distribution in the data. If I take initial income of 1, that's the best position you could have been in yesterday. And if you get the worst shock and you're right at the top, the fact you were at the top doesn't count for that much. And you fall right down. And that's the kind of job ladder model. It doesn't happen very often, but it does happen. Of course, you're still relatively high relative to the low-income people. But what it says is that things can wipe out your history. Your history can be wiped out. And it's a little bit of a description of what happens in creative destruction or in recessions, which you don't find in the standard model. And we find it in Norway for labor income, at least. And what we do, the way you think about this now, is very simple. We call it, it is conditional quantiles. So what happens is that the way today evolves depends, the quantile of the way, you know, your ranking from 0 to 1, so Q is just a ranking of the eaters. So my permanent income today, say I'm at the 99th percentile today. What was I yesterday? That's the eater T minus 1. And UT is the rank of the shock. So that's completely flexible. And with a nice lot of data, you can make that flexible. And here's a really good use of non-parametric econometrics, is just to draw. And what I drew you was exactly that. And in fact, what the model delivers, this is the actual estimated model. What I gave you before was the data. And the only way you can fit the data is to have that type of model. And in fact, all the models I've been using in many papers would have given almost a completely flat surface here. That is pretty much the same pass-through. And you don't learn, and what we now know is that that for most of the time, for most of the data you're in the middle, it doesn't matter, but then you get these big, occasional big shocks, and it's a very poor description. It also means there's a lot more uncertainty in the economy than the simple model suggests. And this gives you a different view of why people are more cautious in some aspects of their behavior, both in wealth accumulation, saving, and in the labor market. So that's a kind of little review of that. And what it, you can, if you want to be fancy, you can put, you might say, is that significant? That's 95 confidence intervals. Of course, they're three-dimensional, but you have to go three-dimensional here. There's these dimensions, and you can see that that is definitely a nonlinear process. So I recommend people really start thinking about this. There's some great work now on tax data which is showing this phenomena is quite strong, and it suggests things like job ladder models, what have you. And what you can do with this, I won't spend too much time on this, but now when you're tracking a shock, you can look at different people with different assets. You can take someone high income, say the 90th percentile, get them, what happens if they get a 10th percentile shock, do they have relatively high assets or low assets, depending on their age. So all the things I was describing before, you can look at again, but with these different types of distributions. And I've got lots of that. That's in a recent piece of work. But the idea here really is to allow a little bit more complicated driving process for this. Note it's still statistical. I haven't kind of said I am going with a job ladder model or a particular structural model. What I've got here is a relatively statistical model that nonetheless maps in better to some of the things economists have been suggesting are prevalent. Then I'm going to finish up with just looking a bit more at some of the mechanisms that I'm writing a review, so of course it's huge, and apologies for that. I slimmed it right down yesterday, but still not enough, but anyway. So just looking at these four aspects, because up to now I've kind of grouped income together, but of course you can separate it out, and in fact that explains the two things together, the kind of outlying shocks, which are particularly prevalent, by the way, for male wages, which kind of describes some of the unusual behavior that we've seen, together with the reactions of other people in the family, do quite a good job of explaining what's going on. And I want to just give you a bit of insight into that, because we can then explore distributional dynamics right the way through. So you start by thinking, how does the family work? Remember, we're just studying these shocks that hit people for whatever reason. How does the family work in terms of providing insurance? Well, you might think, well, maybe people, you know, when they couple up, if they are in a couple, they choose a labor market so that they get insurance. That means that, you know, me and my partner choose employment which have negatively correlated shocks. And by the way, that never happens. People couple up for other reasons than insurance. It's always positive. So shocks are positive. In fact, unbelievably, perhaps many people work in the same institution that are in couples. And of course, if the institution goes down, then both of them go down together. And the famous cases of that in the US were people working for the same credit company just before the collapse. There's no insurance through wages, that's for sure. There might be some people doing this, but most people get married or couple up for other reasons than insurance in the labor market. What about preferences? There could be insurance there, and of course Becker has this kind of specialization, which is a kind of insurance, and of course we don't find that either. What we find is that people actually like each other's company, and so you can call it loving or caring preferences. They like spending time together. Well, most people do. And so there's an average, you don't get much insurance there either. So it's not that somehow, you know, as soon as you don't work, I'm going to work, you know, that kind of insurance. I'm going to show you it's a bit more nuanced than that. And that's where the persistent changes come in, kind of quite nicely. In fact, in economics, that's called the difference between Frisch and Marshall. So Frisch complements are complements that are complements in today's preferences. So other things given, if my partner's at home, I prefer to be at home. That's the kind of idea. And we always find that. You know, that's why couples like to retire together. You know, you've generally, of course it's not, there's heterogeneity, but overall you find that. But if there's a persistent decline in somebody's economic fortunes, then the reverse happens. You get what's called a Marshall substitute. So you get substitutions when things really go wrong for one of them, unless you have to put time in caring, of course. But typically, and you see this happening in the data, it was getting obvious in the US description of inequality. There was a paper by Alter and Katz which showed that women were holding up the bottom of the distribution in the US, as men were beginning to drop it out of the labor market or have very low wages. And I kind of showed that right early on. And this is the idea that I put it like this: you might love to spend time together, but you have to eat. So of course, if the budget's really hit, then there's gonna be a reaction if you don't get money from other sources. And of course, this is where you can examine really whether families can draw on other networks, like other family members, which in societies like the US is absolutely zero. you can't find anything going on, you know, of any magnitude. It obviously happens, but not in any magnitude. So a persistent shock, and I'd say to his wage, because I'm thinking of these effects on white men, will depend on how what assets they have and other things like that. So that's going to be the idea, and that's what we look at here. So one thing it depends on is imagine you're in a couple for a minute here, if he gets a shock to his income, persistent, then it depends how important his income is in the whole income of the family. Generally, of course, male earnings have been higher than female earnings of the family. This is heads in the US, these are all education groups. I'm going to look at low education in a minute. Generally, the men are around 70% of overall earnings. But of course, when women come back into the labor market after having children, it drops down again. That's the average. There's a huge distribution of these. This is the fifth to, well, maybe not so huge, but there's a distribution of these in the data. So you can, if you've got data, you can put together the value of his earnings, just monetary value, versus hers, and then if his gets hit by a shock, how important is that? That's the first thing. That's without her doing anything. If she can still keep her income, it won't obviously reduce consumption or family income quite so much. So this is where. The other thing you could use is assets. This is the little pie thing, so it's assets to assets plus human wealth. It starts very low. This is average in the US, with the amount of net value of assets in the data as well. Around ages of 30, 34, this is couples in the US, so it's a selected sample of couples. I'm going to look up. I probably won't get a chance, but I look at singles and how they react. But as you expect, even the average is very, very low. And if I look at the distribution, this is the percentiles again, for the young households, their level of assets relative to human growth is negligible. They have nothing. And of course, so assets are going to do nothing for them. And they can't borrow because they're borrowing. They're in a bad, if they've had an adverse shock, the last thing you can do is borrow apart from a little bit of credit card debt. And so what we can then do there is say, well, if we take what we find in the data, relatively a 10% permanent decline in male wages relative to the female wage, what happens in these families? Well, the red line is what would happen if there was no reaction in the household at all, just the 70%. So that's the 70%, 7%, because it's a 10% fall. And it's broadly flat. But in fact, the fall in consumption is much less. As we saw, there's quite a bit of insurance, and that was one of the puzzles. The way it's made up is largely through family, other members supplying labor. There's no, and the tax and welfare system. There's nothing going on through assets. The blue line is once you allow for assets as well as family labor supply. The green line is just the family labor supply adjustment. For those in their mid-age, it's all happening from other family members, and there's also a kick from the state, at least for the low earners. So this is the kind of thing you can do. Then you can put the whole, that for everyone in your sample. And so what I'm doing here is kind of thinking, there's a set of shocks to wages, how does it end up in family consumption? So it was the original kind of theme. How do I go from the shocks in the labor market right through to the distribution of something a bit more closer to well-being, perhaps, if you think consumption measures that? And that's the idea there. So what we find is that for the low-income group, at least, family labor supply and young, the family labor supply is quite an important thing. And that's always been a puzzle. In fact, I wrote a paper for the Becker volume that's coming out soon, because if you've got loving preferences, you're just never going to get that amount. So it's the dynamics of it. You get you particularly get these offsetting effects, of course, when there's a disastrous big effect to one income in the household. It's kind of obvious, really. So just to kind of think of that. It's not that there's anything peculiar about preferences. They still like to be together, but of course, with a big shock, they would offset that. So that's what this says, and it's a little bit about it. So in fact, quite surprisingly, once you put all these bits together, you can map from the wage shocks through to consumption pretty carefully. It's almost like an accounting, accounting piece of work with these dynamic reactions. So it's quite simple in some ways. But where do the hours come from? So this is the last thing I thought I'd tell you about and then finish. Sorry for going on. But it's fun to look at time use data. And so this is one thing that surprised me. I assumed that people who collect time use data were brilliant at survey design because they weren't economists. And that is far from the case, by the way. So just for the economists amongst us. And I'll give you the example. When you collect the American Time Use Survey, which is probably the biggest and most used, when it goes to a household and asks someone how much time they're spending doing various things in a couple, it only asks one of the couple. It doesn't ask the other one. So, of course, that's fine on aggregate because you get aggregation conditional and things. But if you want to look at how the correlation within a couple, it's much harder to do. And so that restricts what we can do, by the way. And worse than that, it asks some at weekdays and some at weekends, but none both together. So it's very much a kind of let's get the averages right, but not the correlations. And that's quite interesting. But that aside, what we find is that once you look at the shocks and bring the time use in, what we think of is a kind of Becker type model, but it doesn't have to be a Becker type model. It's just time being used with children, and we get these kinds of effects where this is again you'd get the 10% the decline and it's going to be the man's income in a couple. The woman jumps up in the amount of hours in employment she does. Of course, some women can't do that, but this is just on average in the data. And there's a big effect, both intensive and extensive margin. Nothing particularly surprising about that. Although, you know, it's quite interesting that this is kind of backing up the family labor supply idea. What happens, this is just the average effect on time use with children, and it's almost all offsetting. I've got lots of accounting bits for different types of families here. This is for a low-educated family, let's say, where the man is low-educated. It's a couple, not a single. But what happens here is that she drops almost hour for hour her time with children in exchange for going to work, which is surprising. It doesn't happen for the high-educated women, but it happens for low-educated. We don't have draw any implications for that. But that's not what I expected. And I was told that wasn't what we were going to find. We would find that it was very, very resistant to change in time of children. But in fact, that doesn't seem to be the case, subject to these shocks in the family. And that's quite important. I won't spend any time on that. So that's the kind of idea. So I told you it was experimental, this bringing all the bits of work together. I don't know whether it's worked, but it was fun to do. And what I've tried to do then is link from kind of these baseline labour market shocks, which I've argued are quite important in describing the evolution of the economy over the last two or three decades, and the relative position of men and women as well, and how. And then the economic consequences of those. There are lots of other social, political, but working through from wages, earnings, joint earnings, income, and consumption, and finding this key role for unusual shocks, nonlinear persistence, and then documenting how these different mechanisms work. So I hope what I've kind of tried to do here is show the value of high-quality data on household earnings, hours, consumption, and assets, because I don't think GSERP still doesn't collect consumption. I think that's right, or maybe it's starting, Peter. And I think there's good reason for both either using administrative data or improving so that we get both the time use and consumption in these cases. And of course, where you have these administrative data, you can learn a huge amount. In fact, many of the ideas came from looking at the administrative data and then going back to the survey data. Once you know what you're looking for, you can kind of find it. It's quite interesting here. I just wanted to point out that it's really, you know, there are so many other aspects of work that this opens up. And there are kind of a couple of points here. This is what I described isn't a good model for high educated. And it's because, and the reason why, you know, women and men of high education tend to stay, you know, fairly intensely in careers, even through child-rearing period, is because of the experience payoff, the human capital payoff, which is very important. It's almost non-existent at the bottom of the distribution, we find. The other thing that's not been described at all is how the housing market comes into this, and that's a big big project, but I didn't describe it here. But just to show that once you've got this idea, you know, the last recession, at least in the UK and in particular in the US, there was a house price shock and a labour market shock. And what that does is, and they were persistent, so you get a persistent shock, and also you don't have assets to insure it suddenly. So you get this kind of double whammy. And that model is very, very nice at pinning those two together because it gets the kind of two effects together. So I just run through these just to point out there's much more to this work, but I wanted to kind of see if I could persuade you these dynamic linkages are fun to look at and important for inequality. And we have a lot of fun doing it, so that's that. That's it.
For the fascinating talk. So we have time for a few questions. So if there's anyone who wants to ask a question, then he or she can raise the hand and we'll have a micro come up because the acoustics is not terribly good in this room. Okay. McCartan.
I was wondering if you could help a bit with the intuition for that beautiful 3D graph. So if I'm reading it right, it's saying that for people at the top of the initial income distribution, the bigger the shock, the less permanent it is. I'm just wondering, what's the story behind that?
The bigger the negative shock.
That's right, that's right. The worse the shock, that's
it's
right.
There are two aspects to that. It's a good question. I didn't spend enough time on it. So if you're at if you're at the top, there's only one way to go. You could kind of think of it like that. It's like a job ladder model. If you get a persistent, so there are many persistent shocks on the positive side, but you tend to stay where you are. You're just going up the ladder. But if you get a big negative shock, then you fall off it. Of course, the chance of having a very big positive shock up there is very small because you're already at the top. And so having this kind of asymmetric distribution just captures that. This kind of standard model just has you always starting with where you were, and you just add on whatever the shock is. It's kind of just adding on whatever the shock is to your income, whether it was a negative shock, whether it was a positive shock, and wherever you started. So similarly at the bottom, at the bottom, you just kind of run along at the bottom. In fact, it's a pretty depressing place to be, of course. Then there's an occasional escape route, and that's the kind of standard theory that if you occasionally you're lucky enough to get into a good job or a good firm and you're on a ladder, but that happens at least in the UK and the US relatively rarely. And so it's kind of capturing those two sides. But I, when I started this, we saw it in the data. I thought to begin with it must just be a mistake, it just looked too big. But every data set we've looked at now has this feature. And there's something in it, and it kind of makes you worry about just using the plain old vanilla model for risk. So there is some papers now, you know, more structural macro papers that take this model and we'll look at its implications for wealth accumulation and lots of things like that. But I haven't done that here quite. Yeah.
There's a question.
Okay. My comment is, I stay single. I don't want to draw a family in such a situation where children are involved and don't perhaps have a good future to deal with. So this is a very bad situation, and I would say if governments or people do not anything to change such a situation, then the world goes to rot.
Yeah, I didn't make any normative comments on that. You could say it's already happened at the bottom of the distribution in many economies, and the US, the situation of you know, poor families in some economies, certainly in some parts of the US, does look a bit like you describe. So it's already been pointed out in among black families in the US. You know, already there were a lot of single women who were doing much better and just not getting married, and or not coupling up at all. What's kind of happened is that's happened in white families, and so that's kind of you can, by the way, you can look at this and you can see, you know, there's one fantastic fact that again came out of administrative data, and that's the probability of being in a couple when the husband's earnings is higher than the female earnings, and when the female earnings are less than the husband earning, you know, the distribution is kind of nice, then it suddenly drops down. The probability of being in a couple when the woman is earning more is almost like a step down. And that's just descriptive, but if you take these shocks, if they are shocks, then you can see that persistent shock to male earnings typically has a bad outcome on the family as well. So there are lots of things to explore here, and I agree with you. You know, that's you could, looking at this, say these, you know, we could introduce social insurance, which would do a much better job than these families are able to do themselves. And of course, some countries do have that. Norway is a good example.
Thank you very much for this fantastic talk. Do we have any information on what happens to the second generation?
Yeah.
Like, for example, if a poorly educated mother who increased their labor force participation spend less time with their children, do those children go more to external child care, and that maybe that they even profit from this decrease in time spent with their mother?
Yeah, good point. Yeah, in a kind of very rational kind of model, it's completely rational what's happening here. You know, I don't want to push it too far, but we know that women, you know, I used to have a very simple model of childcare where you bought childcare at a going price, let's call it, as an economist would. And if you were a woman earning a huge amount, you'd just buy more of it. But it turns out you do, but you buy much higher quality. That's obvious. Almost linearly. So if you work out the amount you spend per hour on childcare, is almost goes up in line with the wage of the mother. Of course, quality of childcare may not go up like that, but let's assume it probably goes up. So the possibilities at the bottom are you know, relatively poor childcare, typically childcare, informal childcare, with family members or relations, I think, in the US that would be maybe different here, certainly different in Norway. And it's true that mother's education is very important for child upbringing, so if she has very little, maybe that's not such a big cost. And when you see the few experiments I've seen, which have induced women welfare on welfare into work and then followed their children, the outcomes of the children are kind of mixed. As far as I can tell, it's a kind of bizarre, you might know these better. There's one nice experiment in Canada of a tax credit reform where they follow the children. And we're trying to do that here, by the way, but it's relatively, we haven't finished that yet. But they find it has a negative effect on their mental health, but a positive effect on their test scores at school. They're relatively marginal, so it's really mixed. And it's quite interesting, when the report came out, they didn't mention the mental health effect because it was a very positive report. But in fact, it goes both ways. So I think the mother-child relationship, even in poor families, is obviously potentially quite valuable. And I guess we need to, all we've done here is kind of document, try it in a kind of relatively rigorous way what happens. And you can then follow these children, but the problem with, you know, it's gonna be take a while and they're relatively infrequent. But yeah, that's a good, we don't know yet. This might be a good thing, but it was a surprise. Most people thought that the effect would just come from, let's call it leisure time, though, because you're counting time use. And in fact, that doesn't happen. Because you know the time with children, time at work, time doing household chores, and time doing watching the TV, stuff like that. And the thing that gets hit is time with children. So that's all, which was surprising to me. It's, you know, yeah.
One short last question, which actually refers to that point. Ah. You said that for the more educated mothers, yeah, you don't see the same relationship, yeah, right? And my question would be, so where in the 24 hours of the day do they take, yeah, out the yeah, working hours?
Yeah, sleep. I've been told.
Okay,
yeah.
So that doesn't come out of the time use?
It does, yeah. So you get all time use. What's surprising, I mean, I exaggerated a bit. What happens is there's no drop in time spent with children. One is higher educated women spend a lot more time with their children, and so do fathers, but particularly the women. I think it's reading and other engagement. It might be slightly the survey. You know, it's possible, this is a survey, so it's possible that they answer differentially. That's something to be explored, but generally they attribute a lot more time with children, and it's certainly the case, the payoff seems to be high, the investment in child's human capital, reading, looking after, seems to be kind of huge among high educated couples. So I think that's been documented elsewhere, so it fits together with this. Yeah.
I think that's a good moment to end and to continue the discussion with wine and pretzels in front of the room. You're all cordially invited, but let me thank Richard for the fascinating talk. Thanks so much.
Okay. And